Start with the fallout from the collapse of the Silicon Valley Bank. European markets are sulking in trade despite a rebound in financial stocks across Asia and Europe. Last night, mid-sized bank stocks in the U.S. staged a recovery, even though Moody's downgraded its outlook on the U.S. banking system from stable to negative. The U.S. regulators also weighing stricter regulations for smaller banks. Now, as regulators across the world race to avoid a contagion, Asian financial stocks have also recovered in trade. But European markets have opened sharply lower and financial stocks have seen a fresh bout of selling pressure. The IMF believes the Silicon Valley Bank issue will not have a ripple impact on countries like India. Union Minister Rajiv Chandrasekhar met startup executives has promised to help. Sandeep Naik, the head of General Atlantic in India, believes while startup valuations will correct further, capital will not dry up. Take a look.
Based on the actions taken by the U.S. authorities, this situation has been controlled, and when we look at the impact in other countries, including India, so far it's been very small. What you saw in this particular case was an institution that was affected, but that had very unique characteristics that cannot be generalized.
Clearly, it is a liquidity issue because there is going to be a delay. As we understand it from today's engagement with the startups, between when the startups want the money that they have deposited in the bank versus when the deposits will be made available to them. We hope to have that problem addressed by the RBI and the Ministry of Finance pretty soon. The government of India under Prime Minister Narendra Modi ji is absolutely laser focused on their financial well-being.
Globally, there's been a big shift in terms of what's happening, but that's around valuations, Shireen. It's not that tech or technology startups are not still getting the capital that's needed. The valuations have significantly corrected, and rightly so, because there was a lot going on in terms of valuations which were having a meteoric rise much ahead of the performance of the companies. Is capital not looking to go into these startups? Absolutely not.
Well, let's talk about the Lal Street, which failed to hold on to its opening gains. After the fall in the European markets, we saw our markets decline as well. The Nifty and the Sensex have seen cuts of 0.5%. Financials taking it on the chin. Nifty Bank ending 1% lower. HDFC, ICICI Bank were the big losers. BSE companies have raised a market cap of over 50,000 crore rupees. Today, Prashant is standing by with the details. Prashant, nervousness setting in once we saw Europe open and stocks falling there led to a fall in our markets as well.
Another down day, almost 70 points lower on the Nifty. And in the last four sessions, the Nifty has lost about 750 points. Banks under pressure, but nothing like, not yesterday. Yesterday also banks did not do too badly, but the intensity there has come off a little bit on the downside. But they were down once again. The big loser and winner was, of course, the metals index, which was the winner, and the FMCG index, which actually was the loser. I'll start with the losses on the Nifty. Bharti, IndusInd Bank, Reliance, the heavyweight, lost about nearly 2%. SBI and HUL were down as well. Gainers in the form of Asian Paints, Tata Steel and Titan, which were down. Now, the Adani Group stocks were up. They actually flipped around. They were lower in the morning, but they ended higher mostly. Adani Enterprises, Ports, Adani Total were some of the notable gainers. Last two sessions, they'd actually seen some cracks. Now, in the broader markets, it was very strongly in favor of advances for the first half, but it completely reversed. Lots of them coming through. Mahindra CIE, Spark, IRB, Phoenix Limited, KNR Construction and more. But I have to say, numerically, like I said yesterday, there were more losers, but it was not hugely, in a big way, volume-led downsides coming through for some of these mid-caps and small-caps. I guess it's back to watching what the global scene throws up our way. To be fair, overnight, you had a very positive handoff, 2% on the NASDAQ, but the market, of course, here has ended lower. So we have some bit of our own local problems as well, which I think is keeping things on the boil. On top of that list, of course, is FII selling, which has intensified over the last 3 or 4 days. Back to you.
Prashant, many thanks for joining us. As Prashant was pointing out, the Adani Group had a mixed day in trade today. And Adani Group spokesperson has told CNBC TV 18 that special purpose vehicle controlled by Vinod Adani owns cement majors ACC and Ambuja. Now, this statement puts to rest all speculation on Vinod Adani's relationship with the Adani Group companies. Vivek joins us now with all of the details. Vivek.
Well, thank you for that. You know, the Adani Group stocks continue to remain in focus after a morning context story published on Monday, 13th March, which reported that Ambuja Cements and ACC are owned not by the Adani Group, but by Vinod Adani-controlled entities. In fact, what we've done is we've gone through the entire disclosures made in the open offer document and have independently verified that for Ambuja Cement, that the open offer document was made by an entity controlled by Vinod Adani. The disclosure reads, the ultimate beneficial ownership of the acquirer, that is Endeavour Trade and Investment Limited Mauritius, is actually held by Vinod Shantilal Adani and Mrs. Ranjaben Vinod Adani. The chart on your screen actually indicates the multi-tiered SPV ownership structure of the group. An Adani Group spokesperson actually told CNBC TV 18 that when you're talking about this particular Endeavour Trade and Investment Limited, controlled by Mr. Vinod Adani, the acquirer of ACC Limited as well as Ambuja Cements Limited, belongs to the Adani Group. This fact has been disclosed in our public offer document dated 19th August 2022. The point of concern on this is that the Adani Group had indicated in its response to Hindenburg's allegations that transactions with Vinod Adani entities did not qualify as related party transactions. And as per Indian laws, Adani Group's response on the non-disclosure of related party transactions with Vinod Adani Group entities said, and I quote, all transactions entered into us with entities who qualify as related party under Indian laws and accounting standards have been duly disclosed by us. Further, these have been carried out on arm's length in accordance with applicable laws. Vinod Adani does not hold any managerial position in any Adani-listed entities or their subsidiaries and has no role in their day-to-day affairs.
Many thanks, Vivek, for joining us. In fact, staying with that, Jukshinder Singh, the Adani Group CFO, had spoken to us on the 30th of January after the Hindenburg report was released. The CFO had said he had never had a business meeting with Vinod Adani in his 11 years at the conglomerate. Take a look.
I'm the senior most finance executive in Adani Group. I've been there for 11 years. In 11 years, I've not had a business or working meeting with Mr. Vinod Adani. Reason is very simple. He's not the executive in the business. And even I am not aware of how he manages his family offices or how, you know, XYZ manage their family office. It's completely separate. And many promoters in India have this. Their family offices are completely separate from their businesses. The same thing is here.
Well, that was the Adani CFO saying that he's never had a meeting with Vinod Adani. We just told you that as far as the control is concerned, the SPVs that control ACC and Ambuja, the beneficial ownership there lies with Vinod Adani, which has now been reiterated by the Adani Group in its statement. The Adani controversy continues to hamper proceedings in Parliament. Leaders from 18 opposition parties being stopped at Vijay Chowk today by the police as they were taking a protest march from Parliament to the Enforcement Directorate headquarters. Parties had planned to submit a memorandum seeking a detailed probe into the Adani Group.
हमको जाना देना चाहिए था हम तो वहां जाकर तो पीसफुली मेमोरेंडम देकर अपनी बात रख के वापस आते थे लेकिन ईडी ने भी मना कर दिया वो बोले हमारे को इत्तला नहीं है हालांकि हमने इत्तला पहले ही भेजा है सरकार तो विजय चौक से पहले ही रोक दिया
हम कोई रोकने का जरूरत नहीं है हम पहले से भी सरकार के द्वारा हम पूरा खुले हम हमारे नरेंद्र मोदी जी सरकार का पॉलिसीज के बारे में हम पूरा चर्चा करने को तैयार है हम कोई पीछे जाने वाले नहीं है क्योंकि हम देश के लिए भला करने वाला सरकार है देश को गौरव लाने वाला सरकार है गरीबों का सेवा करने वाला सरकार है इसीलिए हम किसी से डरते भी नहीं
Well, a quick check of some of the other headlines this evening. Reliance Jio has hiked entry-level tariffs for new postpaid plans, which remain cheaper than the rival Bharti. It's also introduced the cheapest available family postpaid plan at 696 rupees a month for a family of four. A high-priced family plan is also available for 996 for a family of four, which is comparable to Bharti Airtel's plan at 999 rupees. Credit Suisse Neelkanth Bishra is reportedly stepping down as the co-head of Asia-Pacific Strategy. He's likely to join Mumbai-based Axis Bank's research department. CNBC TV 18 has written to Axis Bank and is awaiting a reply. Food inflation still remains a major concern for India. That's the word coming in from Suresh Narayanan, Chairman and MD of Nestle India. He was part of the B20 Summit on Digital Transformation. Speaking to us, Narayanan said while the rise in food prices remains an issue, the overall demand picture continues to be strong.
Food inflation is still on us. We cannot wish it away and we cannot assume that it's not going to be haunting us for a while. For me, the agenda is really full with all the opportunities that I can unlock locally and also with the overall consumer sentiment being reasonably positive.
Well, that's Nestle's Suresh Narayanan on food inflation. After staying in limbo for the last many years, the Sahara Ponzi scheme case is back in the spotlight. Sources tell CNBC TV 18 that Home Minister Amit Shah is set to hold a meeting today to try and resolve investor issues. The government will discuss ways to provide relief to investors who have claimed that they lost their money and that over 1 lakh crore investors from Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, Bihar, UP and West Bengal had invested in the scheme. On to a CNBC TV 18 exclusive, we learned from sources that the Max Financial deal to sell promoter stake has hit a roadblock. The Analjeet Singh-led promoter group wants to sell only 7% of its 11.45% stake. However, the interested PE players want the entire promoter stake. Now, Ola has offered to replace the front fork arm of over 2 lakh electric scooters. CNBC TV 18 learns that the Ministry of Road Transport had directed Ola to explain and investigate complaints related to the front fork arm 3 months ago. Parikshit joins us now with more details. Parikshit, explain this to us. Ola is saying that this is essentially not a recall. It's a voluntary exercise. People can choose if they wish to replace the front fork or not. What does the government make of this?
Well, Ola is saying this is voluntary. There have been complaints, there have been concerns about the front fork arm of their scooter. These complaints are unfounded, but at the same time, they're giving a free upgrade to a new front fork to all their customers. And they are saying they have 2 lakh customers so far, and all of them can get this free upgrade. So in all practical purposes, this is a recall. Now, as per the rules and regulations, a company, when it's going for a recall, has to inform the Ministry of Road Transport, inform them about the reason for the recall, the product which will be replaced, and also the batch of the product where vehicles are being called. This has not been done in this case. Ola is saying this is not a recall. This is only a goodwill exercise to help concerns, address concerns of their customers. But we have got to know that over 3 months ago, the Ministry of Road Transport, on receiving complaints about front fork breakage and displacement in Ola scooters, had asked Ola for an explanation. They also asked them to investigate this matter thoroughly. So it seems that after all those internal investigations, Ola has gone ahead with this move. We also asked our sources in the government whether they will be seeking details from Ola on this latest exercise where they're offering this free upgrade to Ola customers. And they told us that, yes, they will be seeking details on why this front fork arm is being changed, what has led to it, and what is the scale of the exercise as well.
All right, Parikshit, appreciate you joining us here. This is a story that we will be tracking. Time for us to head into a break, but up next, the Bar Council allows foreign law firms and lawyers to practice international law and arbitration matters in India. That and more when we return. The Bar Council of India has allowed foreign law firms and lawyers to practice international law and arbitration matters in India. However, the permission will be based on reciprocity. Ashmit joins us now with the details. Ashmit, this has been long pending, and of course, there has been severe opposition from Indian legal firms on this opening up. Finally, what has led to this?
Well, indeed, it has been a long time coming, and after years and years of debates and after keeping the industry locked out as far as foreign lawyers and foreign law firms are concerned, that is set to change. Bar Council says that as a part of going global, as a part of establishing India, as a part of the international arbitration hub that India is aspiring towards, India is aiming for, this is a step in that direction. But does it mean that you will see tomorrow a British or an American lawyer arguing against someone like a Harish Salvi, Kapil Sibal, or Mukul Rohatgi? No. That is not going to happen. Here's the devil as far as the detail is concerned. The Bar Council of India came out with these rules and regulations, which in principle have thrown the doors open for foreign law firms and foreign lawyers to participate as a part of the Indian legal industry to practice here. However, there are three important takeaways in terms of restrictions that have been placed. Number one, reciprocity. Lawyers and law firms only from countries which permit Indian lawyers to practice in those countries, only from those countries will the lawyers be allowed to practice here in the country. First. Second, they will only be allowed to work in the non-litigious space. So that essentially means that they will not be allowed to argue before the courts, before tribunals, High Court, Supreme Court. The arguing bit is not happening. But what then will the foreign lawyers and law firms do? So the role so far that has been conceived by the Bar Council of India is restricted to matters of joint ventures, mergers, acquisitions, drafting of contracts, corporate litigation, drafting of contracts. That's essentially the area. And international arbitration, that again is a focus area as far as Bar Council is concerned. The third is the foreign lawyers and law firms will have to necessarily register themselves with the Bar Council of India. And these, of course, come with a whole host of supplementary rules and regulations that these foreign lawyers and law firms will have to comply with. So the guardrails may have been put in place, but it does qualify as the Indian legal industry opening up its doors to foreign lawyers as well as foreign law
firms. Yes, one of the few sectors where FDI was continued to be restricted. Ashmit, appreciate you joining us. A quick check of some of the other headlines. Thousands of farmers continue their 200-kilometre long march from Nashik to Mumbai for the fourth day. The Eknath Shinde government is expected to meet representatives from the CPM-affiliated All India Kisan Sabha to discuss concerns. The march is likely to reach Mumbai on the 20th. Maharashtra government employees indefinitely strike, demanding the restoration of the old pension scheme. The strike has reportedly impacted operations in state-run hospitals, educational institutes and government offices. The chief minister has announced a panel to look into those demands. Tensions rise between US and Russia as an American drone collided with a Russian fighter jet in the international airspace over the Black Sea. America claims the Russian jet forced the drone to crash, but Moscow denies the claim. A company linked to the Abu Dhabi royal family invests in Chinese tech giant ByteDance, which owns TikTok. The investments value ByteDance at $220 billion, below the $300 billion valuation set for a recent share buyback. And with that, it is time for us to wrap up this edition of Business 360. Thanks very much for watching. Stay tuned to CNBC TV 18. The news continues when we return.